Okay, hi everyone, and welcome to the daily MCQ session. So we have 14 MCQs this time, and some of them are really different. Okay. So if you observe a mock test paper of April 23, so ICAI has started asking a lot of different questions. Okay, the kind of questions which are not there in module. So some of those questions I have tried to include here, some kind of those questions, and generally daily MCQs always contain some different and difficult questions, so that, you know, when you go to exam, you should not feel like the paper is too difficult. If you have practiced a lot of difficult questions, questions with higher difficulty till the exam, then exam you'll find it easy to face. Okay, ideally you should be done with your entire module, one extra book, MTP, past papers, everything. Okay, fine. And you know, you can always join this channel. I've given the link in the description, so that you get a lot of MCQs to solve daily. So if you scroll up on the channel, there are around 600 MCQs. So that's good for practice. So let's start. You know, they've come randomly. I don't know, 13, 14, 11, 12. Fine, let's start with anyone. 13. A person can either finish 6 math questions or 20 eco questions in 10 minutes. How many minutes does he need to solve 15 math questions and 10 eco questions? Okay. So he can solve either 6 math questions in 10 minutes. Okay. So he needs 10 minutes for 6 math questions. So how many minutes does he need per question? 10 by 6, right? So 1.666 per question of math. Similarly, how many minutes does he need per question of eco? 10 by 20, that is 0.5 per question of eco. Now he needs to solve 15 math questions. So 15 questions into 1.666 per question plus 10 eco questions into 0.5 per question. So let's solve 15 into 1.666666 m plus and 10 into 0.5 m plus. If you press MRC, you get 30, which is the correct answer. Okay, fine. Next. A person has 8 shirts, out of which he needs to carry x shirts on a trip. If he can make the selection in 56 ways, what is X? Okay. Selection. He does not need to arrange the shirts. He just needs to select the shirts. So that means out of 8 shirts, he needs to select X shirts. And we know that this 8CX is 56. So we can directly go by options. 8C7 is not 56. 8C1 is also not 56, right? It is 8. 8C5. Let's check. How do you calculate 8C5? Understand, whenever you are calculating combinations, it will be like this, right? 8 factorial upon 5 factorial into 3 factorial, correct? So always remember, don't write it. Remember from when you're doing it on calculator. So we'll start with 8 into 7 into 6 and so on, okay? But whatever is the highest number from denominator, we will cancel that, right? Because we'll have 5 factorial here and we'll cancel that. So that means we just need to go to 6. So 8 into 7 into 6 divided by remaining number 3 factorial, that is 6. So 56 is the correct answer. So this is the correct option because 8C5 will also be equal to 8C3, right? Because NCR is also equal to NCN minus R. Okay. So B is the correct answer. Next, select correct statement. A and B are perfectly positively correlated. This means that if A increases, B must increase. Understand, correlation does not mean causation. Okay. That means just because two things are correlated does not mean that if one thing increases, other thing will increase. So if A and B are perfectly positively correlated, then we cannot say that if A increases in future, then B must increase. That is wrong. We can just say that in past, when A increased, B also increased. But we cannot say in future also that will happen. So this is not correct. If A and B have 0 as correlation coefficient, they are not dependent on each other. Again, this is wrong. Understand, correlation coefficient only calculates linear trend. Okay, linear correlation. Now, it is possible that they have curvy linear correlation. Maybe something like this, A is equal to B square, right? In that case, you will R will not be able to calculate any correlation coefficient for this in a proper way or something that will make sense. Okay, because correlation coefficient only works for linear correlation. So just because this is zero, we cannot say that they are not dependent. They may be dependent, we don't know, right? Correlation and dependence have nothing to do with each other. So again, wrong. If A and B are negatively correlated, it means we can use A to exactly predict value of B. Again, wrong, because same logic as first one, right? So this is correct. Next. Z has studied only TVM questions for foundation exam. Plus 1 for correct and minus 0.25 for wrong question. And can solve all questions perfectly. He will randomly circle any answer for rest of the questions. So he will only solve TVM questions. The remaining all he will solve randomly, right? If there are 14 questions on TVM and 86 other questions, what are Z's expected marks? Expected marks is expected value of marks. How do we find expected value of marks? We find possible value of X into its probability and we take sum of that. Okay. So let's think carefully. Okay. So he has got 14 questions on TVM. He will get all 14 questions correct, right? So that means he is definitely going to get 14 marks. Now about remaining questions. 86 other questions are there. Understand, probability of getting a correct answer is 0.25. Probability of getting a wrong answer is 0.75 because there are 4 options, right? So out of 86, he has 0.25 probability of getting correct answer. If he gets correct answer, this is the probability. If he gets correct answer, he will get 1 mark, right? So these are marks. So this is X and P. Plus, again, 86 into 0.75, these will be wrong questions that he will get, most probably expected value, right? And for this, we will have to deduct 0.25. So instead of plus, let's write minus and let's multiply by 0.25. So let's do it on calculator. 14 m plus 86 into 0.25 m plus 0.25 into 86 into 0.75 m minus. If you press MRC, you get 19.375, which is the correct answer. 9. If frequency density of a class is higher than frequency density of another class, frequency density means how crowded is the class. Okay, how crowded means frequency upon class length. It indicates that first class has higher frequency. This is wrong because we don't know what is class length. Okay, we don't know what is class length. It is possible that first class has lower frequency but higher class length. If frequencies were number of persons and class length was area, first class would be more crowded. That is correct because density itself means measuring how crowded something is. Okay, first class has more class length. Again, not correct because we don't know frequency and class length. So B is the correct answer. So next is 10th. Arithmetic mean of n natural numbers is n. The sum of these observations will be. What is arithmetic mean? Summation x upon n, right? N observations. And they have given arithmetic mean is n. So sum of these observations, that is summation x, will be what? N square. N square will be perfect square. Option A. Next, 8th. A plot of land which is 4000 square feet costs 86.6 lakhs in year 1. Index number of land prices in the area became 520 from 310 in year 5. Okay. Now understand, 86.6 lakh for 4000 square feet. So how much is the cost per square feet? 86,60,000 divided by 4000, which is 2165 per square feet. This is in year 1. Okay. In year 5, index has become from 310 to 520. So we can just cross multiply this divided by x is equal to 310 divided by 520. So how much will be that x? So 2165 divided by 310 into 520. That gives us 3631.61. Now they're asking how much can you buy? For how much can you buy 200 square feet plot in year 5? So into 200, that will give us our answer. 726322, option B is the correct answer. Next, 7th. 7th term of an AP is 0. What will be the sum of first 13 terms? Okay, sum of first 13 terms. Now, this is an arithmetic progression, right? So understand, let's say that there are 13 terms. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. Now, 7th term is in exactly middle because 13 plus 1 by 2. 14 by 2 is 7. So, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So, exactly middle term is 0. But, see, we know that in arithmetic progression, middle term is the arithmetic mean of extreme terms. That means, this and this, if we take arithmetic mean of extreme terms, it will be 0. That means, these two terms, this and this, last one, 13th one, they are, their sum will be 0, right? Why? Because, you know, first term plus 13th term divided by 2 is going to be 0, right? That means if we get this here, first term plus 13th term is going to be 0. So, sum of these two is 0. Similarly, sum of these two is also 0 because again 7th is the middle term. Again, sum of these two is 0, sum of these two is 0, sum of these two is 0. Sum of these two is also 0. That means sum of everything is 0. None of the above is the correct answer. Okay. Or you could have just done sum of all the terms, summation x, divided by n is arithmetic mean, that is the middle term 0. So that means summation x is also 0, n into 0. Okay. In exam, whatever comes to your mind, first use that approach. For an AP, 5th term is 26, 8th term is 44. If A and D of this AP are interchanged with each other, what is the 6th term of new AP? Okay, it is a confusing question, but not difficult. Easy question, right? 5th term is 26, so 5th term is what? A plus N minus 1D, that is 4D, is 26. And A plus 7D is 44. Let's subtract first one from second one. So, 3D is equal to 44 minus 26, 22. So, D is going to be 22, right? 44 minus 26, 18. So, D is going to be what? 18 by 3, that is 6, right? Yeah, fine. So, A will be what? Let's put it D in this. So, 4D is 4 into 6, 24. So, if we get that to right hand side, A will be 26 minus 24, that is 2. So, D is 6, A is 2. Now, we want to interchange this. Now, for the new AP, we want A 6 and D 2. Now, what is the 6th term? 6th term will be A plus N minus 1 into D. So, that is 16. B is the correct answer. Next. 4th. Differentiate this. Okay. So we'll use chain rule. If you are not, you know, too comfortable with derivatives, I have uploaded my entire free lectures on the channel, so you can go through those. I have explained each and every concept in detail. So for chain rule, you don't need to remember anything other than basic functions, basic conversions. You don't need to remember any other formula. You can just go logically. How will we go logically? Dy by dx will be, what will we do? This is e raised to something, right? If it was e raised to x, what will we do? E raised to x, derivative of e raised to x is e raised to x, right? So let's write that. But this is not x, right? This is not x. So we'll take derivative of that part also. So multiplied by, now focus on this. Log of something. Again, apply the same logic. If it was log of x, then what will we do? 1 by x, right? So let's do 1 by x. So 1 by root e raised to 5x. But it is not x. So we'll take derivative of that also. So into root of something. Again, apply the same logic. If it was root of x, what will we do? 1 by 2 root x. Right? But it is not root of x. This is not x. So, we'll take derivative of that part. Again, e raised to 5x. What is derivative of e raised to 5x? E raised to 5x into, again, 5x derivative is 5. Right. So, if you see this and this, when we multiply, square root will go away. So, what we'll have is, e raised to log of root e raised to 5x into e raised to 5x into 5 divided by 2 into e raised to 5x. Okay. Now observe carefully. E raised to log of something. For this log, base is also e, right? If you remember, there is a property in the chapter of log. A raised to log of b to the base a is nothing but b, right? So here also you have same. E raised to log of something to the base e will be what? That something. So we can just simplify this as root of e raised to 5x. E raised to 5x, 5 to e raised to 5x. E raised to 5x I will be able to cancel. So 5 root e raised to 5x upon 2, option B is the correct answer. Okay. The question looks complicated. I explained it, that is why it took time. But when you are used to this method and you solve by yourself, you will be easily able to do it in 1 minute. Derivative integration questions, generally only 3-4 questions are asked, sometimes even 1-2 questions. But they are generally easy. Okay, fine. Next. First, a line is drawn for inequality this. Will point 3,2 be included in the shaded region? Okay, there is a very easy way to solve this. 3 is x, 2 is y, right? So substitute that in the equation. Minus 2, x is minus 2 into 3. Plus 3y is 3 into 2. Check if it is less than or equal to 6. Okay, let's check. So this is minus 6 plus 6. That is 0. Is 0 less than or equal to 6? Yes. So yes is the correct answer. Next, fifth. A person has taken a loan of 50,000, which is to be repaid in 5 installments, each of which must contain rupees 10,000 as principal plus interest at 10% per annum. What is the total interest to be paid? Okay. This is not EMI. This is not annuity. Why? Because the condition is that you have to repay 10,000 plus whatever is the interest. Okay. How will you calculate? See, for first year loan is 50,000. So how much will be interest at 10%? 5,000. Now, at the year end, you will repay 10,000 plus this interest. So you will repay 15,000 rupees. So now what is the balance? Check. 50,000 was opening balance plus 5,000 was interest minus 15,000 was repaid. So 40,000 is the new balance. Again, 10% interest for second year, so 4,000. Now we'll repay how much? 10,000 plus that interest, that is 14,000. Again, what is the balance? 40,000 plus 4,000 minus 14,000. Check if it is 30,000. Next year interest will be 3,000. Repayment will be 13,000. Balance will be 20,000. If you go by the same logic, you will know that interest is going to be 2,000 and 1,000. So it is just total of all of that. 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5. That is 15,000, option D. Okay. Last two. X plus 3y is greater than or equal to 6 and x plus 3y is less than or equal to 6. It means what? Okay, understand. If something is greater than or equal to 6 and less than or equal to 6 also, that means it has to be equal to 6, right? Because think on a number line, if something is 6 or less, okay, this is the shaded region, and it is also 6 or more, then there is only one common point, which is this 6, right? So is equal to 6 is the correct answer. Last one. There are 12 ways to rearrange a word such that vowels always occupy odd places. Which of the following words can it be? Okay, so it is a reverse question. So let's go by options. Okay, we can see that A is the answer, but still let's check A only. AGIS. We want vowels to be at odd places. If the word is 5 letter word, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then vowels can be this, this, and this, right? How many vowels are there? AEI. So it is easy. 3 places, 3 vowels, so 3 factorial. And 2 places, 2 consonants, so 2 factorial. 3 factorial into 2 factorial is 12. So this is the correct answer. Right? So that's it. I hope this was helpful to you. If you have any doubts, let me know in comments or on Telegram. Don't forget to join the Telegram channel so that you will get to see MCQs like this daily. Also, don't forget to subscribe to the YouTube channel so that you get, you know, I generally upload all the batches, all the revision batches, MTPs and everything for free on the channel. So you can definitely take benefit of that. Okay. Fine. So let's stop here for today. Bye everyone.